Hello, I'm Paul Wakim. I am Chief of the Biostatistics and Clinical Epidemiology Service at the NIH Clinical Center, and this is part four on randomization in clinical trials. And in this part, we're going to discuss miscellaneous points and recommendations. So, threats to the integrity of randomization. We talked about randomization methods, but what are threats to the integrity of randomization? What can weaken the benefits of randomization? Well, exclusion of participants from final statistical analysis. Everybody got randomized, but then when it comes to the analysis, some are excluded from the analysis. Well, that you don't want to do that. You really want to absolutely minimize that, because the more you do that, the more it basically ruins the benefit of the randomization. And same idea, if large number of participants have missing primary outcome, it's the same. It's a selection. And this is particularly concerning because you don't know whether those who are missing data have anything to do with the treatment. So this whole balance on randomization and objectivity and all that is basically compromised. Is this a good randomization? These are questions for you to think about. Is this a good randomization method? So you create two groups of equal size, you know, 16 and 16, and then you toss a coin to determine which group is assigned to which treatment. Is this a good randomization method? No, it is not. Why not? Because you created those two groups. And as soon as human beings are involved in the randomization process, there is potential for bias and basically for bias. Is this a good randomization method? You toss a coin to determine the first treatment assignment, and then you alternate. After the first assignment, you alternate between A and B. So the first one is A, and then you go on for the rest of the trial alternating A and B. Is this a good randomization method? No, it is not. Why not? Because if at any point during the trial, one participant is known which assignment they got, all the next one, all the subsequent one are going to be known and predicted. And you don't want that. Is this a good randomization method? On Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, you assign treatment A. And on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays, you assign treatment B. Sounds harmless, but it is not a good randomization method. Why not? Well, Mondays are right after the weekend, Fridays are right before the weekend, Saturdays are inside the weekend, and we don't know whether the day of the week has anything to do with the treatment, with the recovery, with the primary outcome. We don't know. And so we don't want to take any chances, and we just need to avoid that kind of randomization method. So what is the connection between randomization and predictability? One of the main goals of randomization is to prevent the ability to predict the next participant's treatment assignment. That's the connection. What's the connection between randomization and blinding or masking? Randomization protects from selection bias, and masking protects from clinician assessment bias and participant response bias. So again, randomization, you're basically making sure that they are assigned completely objectively. Blinding or masking is you are trying to have both the participant and the provider and the clinician not know, so they are not biased one way or another in the assessment or in the way the participant responds to the treatment. What is the connection between randomization and intent to treat? Intent to treat is a principle that says basically every participant who is randomized should be analyzed. So without ITT, intention to treat analysis, the benefits of randomization are significantly weakened. So if you'd really, it's a little bit like to the previous point, if you really want to analyze all the people that were randomized, and if you start selecting subgroups, for whatever reason, you are compromising the benefits of randomization. What is the connection between randomization in a clinical trial and random sampling for a survey? And that's where the representativeness, something I talked about at the very, very early, is about. So one main goal of randomization in a clinical trial is to balance known and unknown baseline characteristics. That's one of the main goals. So the participants that you do have, you want to balance them between the treatment groups. For surveys, the purpose of random sampling for surveys or random selection is to obtain a representative sample. You want that those who are being surveyed are representative of the population out there. So here's the question. Is the group of participants who's getting randomized representative of the population with the disease you're studying? Remember, at the very first slide I had, is I had this sequence of filters where you start with all those who have the disease you're studying, and then you go down and you say, okay, well, do they really want to participate in a clinical trial? Do they really, are they eligible? Do they meet the inclusion exclusion criteria? Do they want to, do they consent? And then they get randomized. So they have to go through all these filters. When it comes to randomization, are those who get randomized representative of that very first block of all those who have the disease? Chances are they are not. They are not representative. Well, think of it this way. I mean, people who consent and who don't want to consent, are they different in terms of what you're studying, in terms of the outcome you're measuring? We don't know. Think of the, for example, those who live near the site of the trial versus those who live far away from the site of the trial. Of course, you would think that those who live nearby would be more likely to join the trial versus those who have to travel a long way to get to the clinical site. Well, are those who live far any different from those who live near the site? Maybe yes, maybe no. The sites themselves, if you have a multi-site clinical trial, the site themselves, are they representative of all the sites that provide this kind of treatment? Chances are they are not. Investigators tend to select sites that have big volume of participants or of patients. So chances are, or maybe with there are a little bit, we call sometimes elite sites, you know, good staff, good organization, et cetera, et cetera. So chances are the sites are not representative. The sites that are participating in the trial are not representative of all the sites that provide this kind of treatment. So here's the bottom line. The bottom line is in surveys, you take a random sample for representativeness purposes. In clinical trials, you probably don't have representativeness, but the randomization assigns the treatment in a balanced way based on known and unknown characteristics. What is the connection between randomization and equipoise? Equipoise is basically where we really don't know whether the two treatment interventions being studies, being compared, are really, is there clear evidence that one is better than the other? We don't know. That's equipoise. We may have a personal opinion. We may have based on experience or whatever. But we really don't have final evidence that one is better than the other. That's equipoise, and that's why we're running the clinical trial, to find out. So the question is there a connection between randomization and equipoise? So what is the connection? Well, randomization is ethical as long as there is equipoise. You cannot randomize people to an inferior, a known inferior intervention. That's unethical. What is the connection between randomization and statistical analysis? Well, here I'm quoting from a book by Friedman et al. That says, unless the data analysis performed at the end of the study reflects the randomization process actually performed, it may be incorrect since standard analytical methods assume a simple randomization. So what this is saying is that the analysis has to reflect the randomization. So, for example, stratification variables should be included in the statistical model. So if they are important variable to stratify, they are important enough to be included in the model. So site should be included in the statistical model. And sex, when you think there's going to be a difference between the two sexes. So recommendations for common randomization methods. Again, this is pretty basic stuff. We're not talking about fancy clinical trials. For common randomization method, use a computer program or an online tool. Use permuted block randomization with small random block size, less than 10. For multi-site clinical trials, use site as a stratification variable in the statistical model. Do not use too many stratification variables, less than or equal to 4. Nothing magic about 4, but just the number. And unless necessary, avoid response adaptive randomization methods. Not both adaptive, just the response adaptive, the one that is basically look at the responses and changes the allocation probabilities. And for complex randomization methods, consult with a biostatistician. It's just too, it gets very complicated very quickly. So implementation recommendations. So now we're talking about really when it comes to implementation, a few tips make it possible to reproduce the string of treatment assignment. So you should be able to say, this is how the treatment assignment got, the treatment assignments got developed. You can reproduce the program that will give exactly the same string of assignments. For auditing purposes, for example, document randomization method used. Put in place features that prevent treatment assignment until conditions for entry into the trial are fully satisfied. What this is saying is that until you have all the person has passed all the filters and is ready to get randomized, this is when you randomize. Don't randomize them before, because if they suddenly drop from the trial, after you randomize them, then you create a problem. Remember ITT principle. So wait until you're pretty sure this is it. They've fulfilled all the requirements. Mask blind assignments to everyone concerned. As much as possible, if you can, mask. In other words, you don't have to reveal any of the schemes or the assignments to anyone. The fewer people know, the better. Make it difficult or impossible to predict future assignments from past assignments. And put in place procedures for monitoring departure from established protocols. So when you have, you've established a protocol and you have procedures, if you're going to depart from those while the trial is ongoing, you want to put places to, you want to monitor these departures. So that's it for this segment. In summary, randomization is ethical as long as there is equipoise. Randomization alone does not guarantee results free of bias. So if you start selecting those you're going to analyze, you may create bias. So just because you did randomization doesn't guarantee everything. The string of treatment assignments based on randomization should be reproducible, and stratification variables should be included in statistical models. And my questions to you are, what are some of the threats to the integrity of randomization? What is the connection between randomization and predictability? And what is the connection between randomization and blinding? Thank you for watching.